Welcome back, geology fans. Geologic hazards is an easily understood term, threats humanity faces from natural geologic processes. Earthquakes and volcanoes present the most shocking of the geologic hazards, but a more common threat falls under the general category of mass movement. Avalanches, predominantly water ice flowing down a slope. Rockfall, rocks, often up to boulder size, falling through the air with no ground friction, often bouncing several times before they finally come to rest. Landslides, a coherent slice of the side of a slope moving downhill, often with minor water involved. Debris flows, a mix of more loosely bound rocks of various size moving downslope with minor water included. Mudslides, like a debris flow, but water is now dominating. And then creeping soil, loose soil and rocks slowly but persistently moving downslope. And subsidence, the sinking of surficial material into empty spaces below, such as mines, caves, washed out sediments, or dissolved out salts. All of these are forms of mass movement, and though we see they can have a variety of ways to display themselves, all can be explained by the force of gravity on the Earth mass overcoming the internal strength of the surface material. In fact, there is a value used by geological engineers called the safety factor, and it is given the symbol capital F sub S, which is calculated F sub S equals shear strength over shear stress. When the safety factor is over 1, the slope should hold. When this safety factor approaches 1, that's when geologists get worried about slope failure. Shear strength in this formula is controlled by such things as friction between soil or rock grains, surface tension of water or precipitated cements. Having material at the bottom of a slope, what we call its toe, it can help prop up the material upslope from it and increase the overall slope strength as well. Shear stress is caused by gravity acting on a mass against a slope surface. Since gravity is a constant at Earth's surface, shear stress varies by other factors. The slope angles that a certain material is exposed to do vary, and it is common sense that an increased angle of slope will increase the shear stress on that slope's material. Another variable is mass. As the result of gravity is weight, and the objects with more mass have more weight to pull material down a slope. With this background information, we can see a few ways to take a slope, starting with a safety factor over 1, and get it to become less than 1, and thus fail as mass movement. This first way is so common, I'm fairly sure you will have seen it at some time in your life. These are road cuts, which often remove the toe of a slope, and end up with a highly increased slope directly uphill from the road itself. A major task of many departments of transportation is identifying and stabilizing low safety factor slopes, or cleaning up after them. Humans also like to build buildings on top of hills, or even on hill slopes, adding weight to the slope. Besides the possible toe removal problem, buildings can also add weight, which can increase the shear stress on the slope and lower the general safety factor in the area. One of the weightiest objects we can build is a water storage tank. This water storage tank in my area was placed on a relatively flat part of the mountain slope, which was further flattened for stability. Of course, to do that, they had to remove the toe and steepen the slope for directly uphill, and that flank is already showing small-scale failure. But you can imagine if that back wall failed enough to compromise the structure of the water tank, or what if that water tank started slowly leaking on its own? This leads us to the far and away number one cause of slope failure: water. With no water in rock or soil, the grains sit right against each other with friction at the contacts, maximum friction. This is the friction that contributes to shear strength, holding the slope together. So dry soil and rock is relatively stable. If we add a little bit of water, though, well, it can actually get a bit stronger at first, as water has one of the highest surface tension values of any substance. We all know that we can get slightly wetted sand to stand taller with steeper sloped sides, if it is slightly wetted. We also know that if you put too much water in with the sand, it will fail and can even be made to flow. Once a slope is saturated, there are no water surfaces to have surface tension, and the water keeps the grains separated, thus reducing friction. This causes the shear strength to decrease, but at the same time, water adds weight, and so increases the shear stress. Looking again at our safety factor, we see that a simultaneous reduction in shear strength and increase in shear stress is the exact things we need to look out for if we're worried about slope failure. These landslide scars were from slides that took place during the Colorado floods of 2015. Persistent rain saturated the slopes and led to failure. And though we started this discussion worried about the weight of the water in this water tank, a recent slide just downslope from the water tank took place without any help from the water in the tank itself. The slide was due to prolonged rains again, which allows for maximum infiltration into the soil and rocks and maximum risk of slope failure. So one should be extra cautious around steeper slopes of less consolidated soil or rock, especially after prolonged rains. Just watch a landslide video collection, you will quickly see all these factors at play. One can also get a forewarning from a slope if it has gradual, slow movement, which could build up into something more sudden and violent. And yet the slow, gradual movement can be just as damaging to a structure as foundations get compressed, tensioned, and sheared apart by the ground below or around them moving. But how does one recognize a slope that might be moving slower than grass grows? We can't just sit and watch such slow movement, but every year, new tree saplings might begin growing in such mobile slopes and give us the indication we need that the slope is in motion. As a tree puts its roots down, those roots get into more stable ground that moves less than the material above them. The base of the tree emerging from the ground gets tilted down towards the direction of slope motion. But a tree doesn't like growing sideways and begins to bend towards the light. Doing this year after year produces a slope featuring gradually bending trees. Each of these slopes we know is in motion because of the bent trees. And if for some reason we couldn't just look at the direction of the slope, which absolutely tells us which direction the slope is moving, we could look at the trees and see the direction the base emerges from the ground, and that also tells you the direction of slope movement. This extreme case in Hawaii is a fallen tree that kept enough roots intact to keep growing in a new up direction. This tree was probably knocked down by wind, but it was growing near fissures on the edge of the caldera of Kilauea, so some ground movement may have been at play. Once a vulnerable slope has been identified, we can try to mitigate, that is, fix the problem. We could remove weight, build up the toe, or as our previous discussion might suggest is most important, prevent too much water from infiltrating or increase the amount of water that drains out of the slope. There are plenty of examples of a slope being identified as at risk, or even in motion, being stabilized by putting in pipes that drain water out of the side of the slope. Bottom line, use the information you learn in your geologic studies to be aware of your surroundings and the potential risks they pose, and then plan for the worst case, especially when you see the warning signs. We will discuss meteorological risks when we get to the atmosphere portion of this series, but we are still in the hardcore geology portion, and when we come back next time, we get to overview the most common geologic structures you will encounter in your own personal explorations, and understand what they can tell you. We begin the first of many episodes covering structural geology when we come back next time, here on Earth Explorations.